हेलो बच्चों, वेलकम टू अमेज़न एकेडमी। गुड मॉर्निंग, हाउ आर यू गाइस? गुड मॉर्निंग एवी, हेलो विंगलेट, हाय प्रवीण, गुड मॉर्निंग जेवी, हाउ आर यू गाइस? क्विक अटेंडेंस बच्चों, दिस इज़ अ इंग्लिश क्लास बाय द वे, एंड वी विल बी डिस्कसिंग द सेकेंड पार्ट ऑफ रोटेशनल चैप्टर इन प्योर इंग्लिश इन दिस क्लास। द इंग्लिश क्लास इज एट 1 PM, राइट? सो आई होप यू हैव लुकड एट द टाइम टेबल। गुड मॉर्निंग बेटा, गुड मॉर्निंग SP, एंड वील बी डिस्कसिंग अबाउट द रिमेनिंग पार्ट ऑफ रोटेशनल मोशन इन टुडेज क्लास। हाय अभिरम। सो बच्चों, बिफोर यू गो ऑन टू द टॉपिक्स, यू नो फॉर श्योर दैट वी आर गोइंग टू डिस्कस DPP। सो इफ यू हैव डन एंड अटेम्प्टेड द DPP, डू लेट मी नो अबाउट इफ देर इज एनी डाउट। दिस इज अबाउट माई सेल्फ बच्चों, फॉर दोज हु आर न्यू, माई नेम इज आशीष गुप्ता, डिड माई BTech फ्रॉम IIT बॉम्बे। आई हैड डिसेंट मार्क्स एंड रैंक बच्चों, आई हैड अ गुड एक्सपीरियंस एज वेल, बट बच्चों घमंड बिल्कुल भी नहीं है, राइट? यू ऑल नो अबाउट इट। हाई सूर्य। सो लाइव क्लास बेस्ट प्रैक्टिस, ज्वाइन द क्लासेज ऑन टाइम, कीप अटेंडिंग ऑल क्लासेज, रिवाइज प्रीवियस टॉपिक्स, बी पोलाइट, नेवर स्पैम, एंड यूज माई डाउट सेक्शन। अपार्ट फ्रॉम दैट, देर आर सर्टन सिस्टम रिक्वायरमेंट्स, यूज आइदर क्रोम और फायरफॉक्स। यू कैन यूज बेसिकली एंड्रॉयड वर्जन 6 एंड अबव। हाय बालू, हेलो, एंड यू विल नीड सम काइंड ऑफ इंटरनेट स्पीड्स ऑफ 5 Mbps एंड अबव विल बी ग्रेट। सो बच्चों, एनी डाउट इन दी DPP, एनीथिंग यू वॉन्ट टू आस्क? गुड मॉर्निंग VK, हेलो अर्णव, हाय NA, गुड मॉर्निंग टू ऑल। आई होप ऑल ऑफ यू आर डूइंग रियली नाइस, या इन हाई स्पिरिट्स। वॉट एवर बी दी रिजल्ट ऑफ मेन्स एग्जाम, यू ऑल मस्ट बी गियर्ड अप टू यू नो गो टू फुल थ्रॉटल अगेन इन द नेक्स्ट अटेम्प्ट, एंड ऑल्सो गेटिंग योर सेल्फ मेंटली प्रिपेयर फॉर बोर्ड्स एंड एंड द JEE एडवांस, राइट? आई होप सो। सो बच्चो, एनीथिंग यू वॉन्ट टू आस्क इन द प्रीवियस क्लास DPP? एनी कंसर्न, एनी क्वायरी, एनी डाउट, डू लेट मी नो। इफ नॉट, देन वील गो फॉरवर्ड टू दी रिविजन ऑफ प्रीवियस क्लास। आई थिंक देयर वी यूजली ट्राई टू रिवाइज सम फॉर्मूले दैट वी डिस्कस्ड इन द लास्ट क्लास, राइट? सो द लास्ट क्लास वॉज बेस्ड ऑन रोटेशनल मोशन, एंड बेसिकली सेंटर ऑफ मास मूवमेंट ऑफ इनर्शिया वॉज डिस्कस्ड इन द लास्ट क्लास। सो लेट मी सी हाउ मेनी ऑफ यू कैन रिकॉल द लोकेशन ऑफ कॉम, लोकेशन ऑफ कॉम फॉर सेमी सर्कुलर रिंग, सेमी सर्कुलर रिंग, एंड यू हैव टू राइट इट डाउन इन योर नोटबुक, ओके? सो डोंट यूज द चैट बॉक्स, यू कैन राइट इट डाउन इन योर नोटबुक। सेमी सर्कुलर रिंग, सेमी सर्कुलर डिस्क, देन यू कैन राइट इट डाउन फॉर हॉलो कोन, सॉलिड कोन, हॉलो हेमिस्फीयर एंड सॉलिड हेमिस्फीयर, ठीक है? ट्राई टू राइट डाउन दी लोकेशन ऑफ सेंटर ऑफ मास ऑफ दीज बॉडीज, एंड देन वी विल चेक, ओके? नमस्ते विष्णु जी। सो अगेन वी हैव टू ऑल्सो राइट डाउन द मोमेंट ऑफ इनर्शिया, दैट ऑल्सो वी डिस्कस्ड द लास्ट टाइम। सो मोमेंट ऑफ इनर्शिया, मोमेंट ऑफ इनर्शिया ऑफ लीनियर रॉड, राइट? सो देर इज अ लीनियर रॉड, एंड यू हैव टू टेल मी द मोमेंट ऑफ इनर्शिया अबाउट दिस एक्सिस विच इज पासिंग थ्रू द एंड, अबाउट द एक्सिस पासिंग थ्रू द सेंटर, राइट? अपार्ट फ्रॉम लीनियर रॉड, यू शुड ऑल्सो रिमेंबर फॉर रिंग, रिंग वी हैव टू एक्सिस, वन पासिंग थ्रू द सेंटर परपेंडिकुलर टू प्लेन, एंड वन इज दिस एक्सिस, ओके? फॉर डिस्क द सेम थिंग, यस यू कैन बेटा, फॉर श्योर है सर, यू कैन ट्राई, यू विल बी एबल टू, एंड वी आर बेसिकली डिस्कसिंग प्रीवियस ईयर क्वेश्चन एज वेल। सो द आइडिया इज दैट आफ्टर डिस्कशन, एंड बेसिकली वी आर नॉट गोइंग टू डिराइव एवरीथिंग, वी आर गोइंग टू डिस्कस अबाउट इंपॉर्टेंट थिंग्स विच आर रेलिवेंट फॉर द अपकमिंग JEE एग्जाम्स, एंड विल होप दैट यू नो मोस्ट ऑफ द क्वेश्चन दैट विल फाइंड ऑफ दिस पार्ट शुड बी ईजिली सॉल्व बाई यू गाइज। गुड मॉर्निंग आर्य। देन बच्चों, यू शुड बी अवेयर ऑफ द मोमेंट ऑफ इनर्शिया ऑफ सिलेंडर, राइट? अबाउट द सक्सेस सॉलिड एंड हॉलो, हॉलो एंड सॉलिड, एंड फॉर स्फियर्स हॉलो एंड सॉलिड. सो दीज आर द मोमेंट ऑफ इनर्शिया आई एम लुकिंग फॉर. सो लेट मी राइट डाउन द कॉम फर्स्ट. आई होप यू ऑल हैव रिटन बाय योर सेल्फ. सो कॉम ऑफ सेमी सर्कुलर रिंग इज 2r/π, डिस्क इज 4r/3π, हॉलो कोन इज h/3, सॉलिड कोन इज h/4, हॉलो हेमिस्फीयर इज 3r/8 और r/2. प्लीज टेल मी फॉर हॉलो हेमिस्फीयर द लोकेशन ऑफ कॉम विल बी एट विच पॉइंट, r/2 और 3r/8. नाउ दिस हैज टू बी बिगर फॉर हॉलो, सो दिस बिकम्स r/2 एंड दिस बिकम्स 3r/8. प्लीज चेक. गुड. मोमेंट ऑफ इनर्शिया ऑफ लीनियर रॉड, मोमेंट ऑफ इनर्शिया ऑफ लीनियर रॉड, दिस एक्सेस इज ml² / 12, दिस एक्सेस इज ml² / 3, रिंग अबाउट दिस एक्सेस विल बी mr² / 2, एंड द सेंट्रल एक्सेस विच इज परपेंडिकुलर टू द प्लेन ऑफ बोर्ड, इट इज mr². फॉर डिस्क द परपेंडिकुलर एक्सेस मोमेंट ऑफ इनर्शिया इज mr² / 2, एंड दिस एक्सेस द मोमेंट ऑफ इनर्शिया इज mr² / 4. प्लीज चेक. हाय मिहिर. या दिस इज द इंग्लिश क्लास विष्णु. द इंग्लिश क्लास टुडे इज शेड्यूल्ड एट 1 PM. ओके. फॉर हॉलो सिलेंडर, दिस इज अ सिलेंडर. फॉर हॉलो सिलेंडर द मोमेंट ऑफ इनर्शिया इज mr², एंड फॉर द सॉलिड सिलेंडर मोमेंट ऑफ इनर्शिया इज mr² / 2. फॉर हॉलो स्फीयर द मोमेंट ऑफ इनर्शिया इज 2/3 mr², एंड सॉलिड स्फीयर इट इज 2/5 mr². प्लीज चेक बच्चों. हाउ मेनी ऑफ यू गॉट ऑल करेक्ट? एनीबडी हू गॉट ऑल करेक्ट? आई कैन ऑल्सो आस्क यू द पैरेलल एक्सिस थ्योरम एंड द परपेंडिकुलर एक्सिस थ्योरम. दैट इज I इज इक्वल टू I0 + MD² एंड IZ इज इक्वल टू IX + IY. राइट. हैप्पी शिवरात्रि टू यू टू SR. गुड जॉब. ओके अंजलि, नो प्रॉब्लम. सेवेंथ क्वेश्चन ऑफ DPP. ओके लेट मी सी. सेवेंथ क्वेश्चन ऑफ DPP. आई थिंक बेटा सेवेंथ क्वेश्चन ऑफ DPP सच टाइप ऑफ क्वेश्चन वी हैव ऑलरेडी डिस्कस इन क्लास. राइट. इट्स नेगेटिव मास कॉन्सेप्ट एंड वी हैव डिस्कस देम इन डिटेल. राइट. सेंटर ऑफ मास ऑफ रिमेनिंग पोर्शन इज O2. फाइंड O2, ऑल्सो फाइंड मोमेंट ऑफ इनर्शिया ऑफ सिस्टम ऑफ O2. सो वॉट एग्जैक्टली आर यू फेसिंग प्रॉब्लम इन, बिकॉज देर इज अ डिटेल्ड सोल्यूशन गिवन. सो वॉट वी हैव टू डू इज वी हैव टू यूज द नेगेटिव मास कॉन्सेप्ट. वी हैव टू यूज द नेगेटिव मास कॉन्सेप्ट, फिल इट विद अ पॉजिटिव मास, एंड यू कैन ऑल्सो अज्यूम दैट देर इज नेगेटिव मास ओवर हेड. सो दिस इज बेसिकली सम ऑफ the complete mass plus the negative mass. So over here this is plus sigma and over here this is minus sigma, and then you can use that same formula, xcom is equal to m1 x1 plus m2 x2 upon m1 plus m2. So you can replace the value of m1 as sigma into pi r square. This will be minus sigma into pi r by how much? This will be r by 3, pi r by 3 का स्क्वायर, एंड जस्ट रिप्लेस इट ओवर हेयर. यू विल गेट द वैल्यूज, पुट x1 एंड x2 प्रॉपरली, देन यू शुड गेट द आंसर ऑफ दिस क्वेश्चन. ओके. एंड आई रियली होप दैट सच टाइप ऑफ क्वेश्चंस हैव टू बी सॉल्व ड्यूरिंग द एग्जाम. इफ यू आर नॉट एबल टू सॉल्व, देन गो थ्रू द कंप्लीट सॉल्यूशन व्हिच इज गिवन एंड चेक वेदर वेयर एट ऑल यू हैव डन एनी सॉर्ट ऑफ मिस्टेक. राइट. फोर्थ क्वेश्चन ऑफ DPP. लेट मी सी व्हाट इज फोर्थ क्वेश्चन. फोर्थ क्वेश्चन बेटा, अ कॉन्स्टेंट फोर्स इज अप्लाइड टेंजेंशियली इफ द मोमेंट ऑफ इनर्शिया ऑफ व्हील इज गिवन. सो यू कैन फाइंड द टॉर्क फोर्स इनटू आर वेव व्हिच वी विल डिस्कस टुडे. सो फोर्स इनटू आर, यू विल गेट द वैल्यू ऑफ टॉर्क, दैट इज इक्वल टू I alpha. सो यू विल गेट द वैल्यू ऑफ अल्फा. राइट. एंड वंस यू गॉट द वैल्यू ऑफ अल्फा व्हिच कम्स आउट टू बी कॉन्स्टेंट, यूज द इक्वेशंस ऑफ मोशन. सो नंबर ऑफ रेवोल्यूशंस इज θ/2π. So basically you can use alpha, initial velocity, angular velocity 0, you are given time. So you will get the value of theta by applying equations of motion. Then solve theta upon 2 pi to get the number of revs, right? And kinetic energy will be half I omega square, right? Is it okay? ZS three question implies what? Third question of DBP. That is the easiest question of this DBP, I guess. Mutual force of attraction is there. So there is no external force, then the momentum remains conserved and the center of mass velocity remains zero. Got it? There is no external force except the internal forces, and internal forces cannot change the momentum of system. So definitely the center of mass velocity does not change and therefore its speed remains zero. I hope this is clear, bachcho. Let's go on to the fundamental concepts, and this is the lesson structure, simple, quite simple, that we are going to discuss about the general standard rotational motion dynamics, and we are going to discuss about fixed axis rotation, which is the pure rotational motion, right? This is the pure rotational motion, and then we will also discuss about the T plus R motion, that is translational plus rotational motion, right, bachcho? So in the fixed axis rotation, we know that a rigid body, when it is moving through a fixed axis, moving across a fixed axis, then it will perform the fixed axis rotation. Now, what all things do we have to consider over here? I think you must all be a little bit familiar with this part, that, you know, when for example, if I just hold the pen at one of the corners and make it move in a circle, then I'm performing a fixed axis rotation. And the fixed axis is going to be this line in this case, right? So what do we have to remember in this fixed axis rotation is, like, suppose a fan is moving in a fixed axis rotation, right? So this is the fixed axis rotation when the fan is moving with respect to this axis. So bachcho, what will happen? Suppose you consider two points A and B. Now, what are the kinematic parameters for A and B? We can say that, you know, omega of A is equal to omega of B. Theta of A is equal to theta of B. Alpha of A is equal to alpha of B. That means the angular parameters of A and B, even though they are moving in different radius, is same, right? Angular parameters remain same. However, the linear parameters do not remain same. What about the linear parameters? Velocity of B is greater than velocity of A. Acceleration of B is greater than acceleration of A. And a distance covered by B is greater than distance covered by A. So this is what we have to consider during this motion, that the angular parameters remain constant, remain same. Angular parameters remain same, but the linear parameters keep changing for different points. Right? So, bachcho, we have to be a little careful over here, and there are certain associated formula in fixed axis rotation, like, you know, for kinetic energy of body. Kinetic energy of body is given by half I about the axis into omega square, right? This is the formula for kinetic energy. And what about potential energy? Potential energy of the same mass rigid body is equal to mgh of com, right? So the height of com into total mass into g, that gives you the potential energy of that rigid body. Is it fine? Any doubt? I think it's very straightforward, very simple. See, you have to remember things, what I'm discussing. We are obviously not going to derive everything right now. We want to make sure that you know about these things, and then you can implement it quickly in the questions, right? So, bachcho, what about torque? Now, torque, the formula of torque is R cross F, which you are familiar with. This is giving you the torque of force about a point. Now, what is that point? This is the point O. And, you know, this is the force. And what is R vector equal to? R vector is the position vector of the point of application of force with respect to point O. So this is torque of force F about O, right? This is the formula of R cross F. And in the scalar format, bachcho, scalar format, we can also say torque as force magnitude into R perpendicular. That means, this is the line of force, right? This is the line of force. This is the line of force. And we can say that, you know, scalarly, if we have to find out the magnitude, then this is the R perpendicular. If you drop a perpendicular from the point to the line of force, then this will be R perpendicular multiplied by force. You will get the value of torque, right? So this is the quick method, fast method to get the same answer, right? Hi, CA. Okay, you were the hungry guy in the previous class. I remember that, yeah. But today I hope that you have taken some sort of breakfast in the morning. I really hope so. So, bachcho, what about torque of force on rigid body? Yeah, Winglet, I do remember you as well. So, torque of force on rigid body, bachcho, useful torque is along the axis of rotation. It is along axis of rotation. So, what we say over here, bachcho, is that there are four cases. So, the first case is if force is passing through axis of rotation, the useful torque becomes zero, okay? Useful torque is zero. Number two, when force is parallel to axis of rotation, again the useful torque becomes zero. Third, force and axis are skew vectors. And, you know, R perpendicular is given as, suppose, X, then the useful torque becomes F into X, right? And in the fourth one, force and axis are skew vectors, you know, R perpendicular with F sine theta is X, suppose, then torque is equal to F sine theta into X. For example, if I take a disc, bachcho, to explain, if I take a disc, then what is the first part going to be? Force is passing through the axis of rotation. Now, the axis of rotation is perpendicular to disc. Okay. So, we are applying a force like this. Obviously, the torque is going to be zero. This is the first case. In the second case, we are applying a force like this. Then also, it won't move, it won't rotate. And therefore, the torque of this force is zero. In the third case, we are applying a force like this, tangentially. And therefore, the R perpendicular over here is capital R. The torque is going to be F into R. And in the fourth case, bachcho, we are applying a force something like this. Okay. And over here, this angle is theta. So, the F sine theta component, we know the R perpendicular for that. And we can again write it down as the useful torque. So, I hope this is clear to all. Simple cases, I hope that torque is something which you all guys are familiar with and not a big deal, not a big problem in understanding these basic concepts. What about rotational equilibrium, bachcho? When net external torque on body is zero, right? So, in that case, the body is in rotational equilibrium. Now, tell me, bachcho, is this rigid body in rotational equilibrium? F and F. Is this body in rotational equilibrium? It is free to rotate about the center of mass. But you no need to write this down. You will get this DPP. You will get this class in the PDF format. So don't have to write it down. Is this rod in rotational equilibrium, bachcho? Good answer, that it is no. This is actually in translational equilibrium, but not in rotational equilibrium, because these two forces constitute a couple, not that couple. It's actually a force couple, a torque couple, in fact. And you can say that, you know, about this point, which is O, torque about O is equal to, if this length is L by 2 and this is also L by 2, then the torque is going to be F into L by 2 plus F into L by 2. That will give you the answer as F into L, right? Please check. And what about this? Is this rigid body in rotational equilibrium? Suppose these two forces are F and these lengths are L by 2 and L by 2. Is this in rotational equilibrium? Now the answer is yes, good job, because these two torques are going to balance each other, they are going to cancel each other. See, you just have to imagine in what direction will this force be going to rotate this rod, and that curl of fingers, right hand fingers, and the direction of thumb will give you direction of torque. So obviously net torque over here, bachcho, is going to be zero, and therefore the rigid body is in rotational equilibrium. However, it is not in translational equilibrium. It is not in translational equilibrium. Right? But it is in rotational equilibrium. You have to be careful. If a body is in equilibrium, then we have to consider both type of equilibriums, translational as well as rotational. Okay? And we should also, along with this, you know, before we go on to solving questions, we should also remember the famous formula tau is equal to I alpha, where I is the angular acceleration, I is the moment of inertia, alpha is the angular acceleration, and tau represents the net torque on the rigid body. So, bachcho, let me see if you can solve this question of J2011, which is a good application of tau is equal to I alpha, and probably using some equations of motion associated with it. I think, beta, it requires a lot of background work to develop the, you know, tech based on which you are giving these papers. So they were already, you know, they had been made. It's not a sudden task of making the papers in a couple of days. It's not like that, right? So in the online mode, it requires a lot of background work, the tech work that goes into it in order to develop the papers. So that is the reason, right? So I think, had the pattern been decided the last year itself, all the papers would have been on the latest examination pattern. But NTA being NTA, they have released the pattern just a while back. So that is the reason. Okay, so a pulley is rotated about an axis by this force applied tangentially. If the moment of inertia is given, then what is the number of rotations made by the pulley before its direction of motion is reversed? Now, this is a very cool question. It's a good question. I don't assume that this is one of the easier questions. But if you have understood the concept behind, you know, the discussion, then you should be in a position to give the correct answer. So, Chirag is giving the answer as A. Although you might take a little bit more time to solve this question, it's not that straightforward. Torque is basically bachcho F into R, because the force is being applied tangentially, right? So the torque is going to be F into R. So that comes out to be 40t minus 10t square. If that is equated by I alpha, I is given as 10, that implies alpha is 4t minus t square. So you get a feel of what is going to happen, because bachcho, over here direction of motion is reverse. That means its omega is basically getting to be zero after some point of time. So if I write alpha as d omega by dt, and performing integration, we can get omega as 2t square minus t cube by 3. I hope all of you can find this. So if I equate this as 0, then bachcho, I get two time intervals, t is equal to 0 and t is equal to 6 seconds, right? So basically the pulley started rotating, but after 6 seconds, its omega again came out to be 0, then it basically will reverse its direction of motion, right? So we have to find the number of rotations. So we have to integrate this equation one more time to get theta as 2 by 3 t cube minus t to the power 4 divided by 12. So basically now you can put t is equal to 6 after taking t cube as constant, 2 by 3 minus t by 12. So at t is equal to 6 seconds, theta is going to be 6 cube. 2 by 3 minus half, and that is possibly going to be 1 by 6, and this will come out to be 36 radian. Now, how many turns would be covered in 36 radian. So number of turns or number of rotations. So rotations will be equal to 36 upon 2 pi. That is less than 6 but greater than 3. Right. So definitely the answer is option A. Please check, bachcho. I hope this is clear. SR, I think if you keep your routine along, routine should be based on the type of what we had shared earlier. And if you follow that routine judiciously and, if you keep revising the concepts, keep revising the topics, then there is a chance that you should be able to score 100 plus marks out of 300. So it's not a very difficult task, right? 100 out of 300 is not that difficult. So if you follow that judiciously, then it will work out well. But if you only attend the classes and do nothing else, I don't think that will be sufficient. Okay. I hope this question is clear, bachcho. Please try. Please try this question now. Yeah, we are talking about March attempt only, bachcho. Great job, AN. Okay, Balu, let's see what is the problem from I alpha. Right, so I alpha, bachcho, I is given as 10. I is given as 10 in the question, so we can get the value of alpha. And if you write this as d omega by dt, we can see that d omega is 4t minus t square dt. And then I can perform integration. T is equal to 0, omega is 0, t is equal to t omega is omega. Then 4t dt integration becomes t square by 2. So 4 upon 2 becomes 2. T square integration is t cube beta 3. I hope this is also clear now. Right? And we have to find the time when it reverses its direction. So basically reversing its direction means that omega at that moment is 0. So if we equate this to 0, we should get the times when omega is 0. And we obviously know that if we start at t equal to 0, then t is equal to 6 will be the time when it reverses its direction. Please check. Is it okay now? So, bachcho, over here, the rod is in equilibrium. Find the tension in the rope and hinge force exerted on the rod. Please try. Find the tension in rope AB and hinge force exerted on the rod. So I have started getting some answers and happy to say that I think the answers seem correct. So bachcho, the rod is definitely in equilibrium. So it will help me a lot as well if you write down your names along with the answers like Surya has done. Because some of the children I do remember and recall their names. But for most of you, I still have less clarity about your particular names, right? So AN is Ankit. Okay, Ankit, good job. I think it's good. With respect to hinge, if we can balance torque, that torque of tension is equal to torque of mg about O, right? Because hinge force does not have any kind of torque with respect to O, so it does not really create any problem. So T into L, bachcho, is equal to mg into L by 2. That makes T equal to mg by 2. So that is the answer of tension. And obviously, it is also in translational equilibrium. So, N1 plus T must be equal to Mg, which implies N1, that is the hinge force, is equal to Mg by 2. So, bachcho, also remember that hinge force does not necessarily apply only in the vertical direction. It can also be the horizontal, but there is no other force to balance in horizontal direction. That is why the hinge force is 0, right? So, my question to you, add-on question is that, find acceleration of center of mass and hinge force at the instant rope AB is cut. Got the question? So suppose rope AB is now cut, right? We go quietly and cut this rope. So at the instant rope AB is cut, what is the acceleration of center of mass and the hinge force on the rod at that instant? Please try, bachcha. And I want all of you to try and get the answer of this correctly. I know that many of you are familiar with the rotational motion, but the important thing over here is that, bachcha, you don't have to commit any silly mistake, right? What is the acceleration of center of mass and hinge force at the instant rope AB is cut? And those of you who didn't get the correct answer of this question, please do check the solution. If there is any doubt, then ask. So I've started getting very different answers for this question. But com acceleration, most of you are giving me the acceleration as 3g by 4. Some of you are giving 3g by 2, g by 2. So a variety of answers are coming out now. But if I draw a free body diagram when the rope is cut, then what are the forces acting which will give torque to this rod? Then the only force that can give torque to this rod is mg, right? Because of this torque, there will be angular acceleration alpha. So I can write down the torque of mg as mg into L by 2, that is equal to I alpha. Now, moment of inertia of rod at the end, bacho, we have already discussed it, that this is equal to ml square by 3, right? ml square by 3 into alpha. So alpha, bacho, comes out to be equal to 3g by 2l, right? Alpha is 3g by 2l. But this is not the acceleration of com, this is angular acceleration of rod. Now, if this is the center of mass, bachcho, and if this rod is rotating by alpha, then we can say that a com is equal to r alpha, and radius over here is l by 2 alpha. So the answer of a com is coming out to be 3g by 4. Please check. Please check. Right? 3g by 4 seems the correct answer for acceleration of com. What about the hinge force, bachcho? So hinge force, we can imagine that over here it is applying on the rod vertically above, and the rod is accelerating downward by 3g by 4. So what is the equation of motion? Mg minus n1 is equal to mass into 3g by 4. That brings hinge force to be equal to mg by 4. Please check, bachcho. Understood this part? Very interesting. It's a very interesting part, and I think most of you must have gone through this part somewhere, sometime or the other in your preparation. Why the hinge force exerts no torque? Anybody who would like to answer the question raised by SA, I think many of you would be able to give the answer, and it's a very simple answer. I don't think it's a very complicated one. Why does hinge force exert no torque? Anybody? Bachcha? Because hinge is passing through the axial rotation. Great job, AN. So the hinge force is actually passing through the axis of rotation. So it does not exert any kind of torque. Right? Okay, SA. So that makes the answer of this question as mg by 4. Now, please solve this question, bachcho. A ladder is resting on a vertical wall, and if the wall is frictionless, this is not. Find the minimum coefficient of friction on the ground for which the ladder does not slip. Now, this is again, I can say one of my favorite questions, which I feel that, you have to be very sure of getting the answer yourself. हैप्पी शिवरात्रि टू यू टू जीएम। आई डोंट थिंक सो बीके, बीके द थिंग इज दैट दिस इज फॉर जेई एंड दिस इज अ क्रैश कोर्स, सो बाय नो मीन्स वी आर गोइंग टू यू नो बेसिकली डिराइव एवरीथिंग एंड डिस्कस एवरीथिंग इन डिटेल। दिस इज बेसिकली गोइंग टू गिव यू एन आइडिया वॉट इज एक्सपेक्टेड, वॉट टाइप ऑफ क्वेश्चन आर एक्सपेक्टेड इन एग्जाम एंड वॉट ऑल फॉर्मुले एंड थिंग्स आर इम्पॉर्टेंट, सो वी आर गोइंग टू ब्रश आर कॉन्सेप्ट अप इन दैट रिगार्ड। सो अ बैकग्राउंड नॉलेज इज अ प्री रिक्विजिट फॉर यूजिंग दिस एज अ रेफरेंस। ओके थैंक यू बी के एंड हैप्पी शिवरात्रि टू यू टू। A ladder is resting on the vertical wall. If the wall is frictionless, find minimum mu for which ladder does not slip. How many of you are fasting today? Is anybody who is fasting on Shivratri today? Is anybody a Mahakal Bhakt? So, sir, I am on fast today. Is it so? Anybody? Oh my God. AN. BK. My God. Nice one, huh? Good. गुड बालू, नाइस नाइस। आई थिंक यू गाइज शुड गिव मी एन यू गाइज शुड इंस्पायर मी टू फास्ट एज वेल। आई ट्राई सम टाइम बट आफ्टर टेकिंग सो मेनी क्लासेज आई डू फील वेरी हंग्री, सो इट्स वेरी डिफिकल्ट फॉर मी टू फास्ट, बट या वेन विल अमेजोन स्टार्ट फुल पेड कोर्स? इट शुड बी वेरी सून, इट शुड बी वेरी सून, राइट? बट नो फिक्स टाइम लाइन, मे बी अ कपल ऑफ मंथ्स, बट इफ यू आर इन क्लास 12 दिन डोंट हैव टू वरी। आई डोंट थिंक यू गाइज विल हैव टू बी इन दैट पेड कोर्स फॉर एवर, सो टिल एडवांस आई डोंट थिंक देर विल बी एनी प्रॉब्लम। सो बच्चों लेट अस डिस्कस दिस क्वेश्चन। सो दीज आर द फोर्सेज एक्टिंग अलॉन्ग विद दैट फ्रिक्शन विल ऑल्सो एक्ट एंड बेसिकली इट इज आस्किंग द मिनिमम क्वेश्चन ऑफ फ्रिक्शन, सो देर विल बी अ लिमिटिंग केस एंड दैट इज वाई अप्लाइड अ लिमिटिंग फ्रिक्शन। ओके सो बच्चों फॉर दिस रॉड विच इज एन इक्विलिब्रियम, ट्रांसलेशनल इक्विलिब्रियम विल बी देयर, सो एन वन इज गोइंग टू बैलेंस एफ एल एंड लिमिटिंग फ्रिक्शन फॉर्मुला इज म्यू एन, सो ओवर हेयर एन विल बी एन टू। सिमिलरली एम जी विल बी इक्वल टू एन टू ओवर हेयर। ओके दैट इज गोइंग टू बी द केस इफ यू रिप्लेस एन टू एज एम जी, देन दी एन वन विल बी इक्वल टू म्यू एम जी। नाउ टू बैलेंस टॉर्क बच्चों वी कैन अप्लाई टॉर्क बैलेंस अबाउट दिस पॉइंट बिकॉज टू फोर्सेज टॉर्क इज गोइंग टू बी इक्वल टू जीरो, सो वी कैन से दैट टॉर्क ऑफ एन वन इज इक्वल टू टॉर्क ऑफ एम जी अबाउट ओ, राइट? सो वेन वील राइट डाउन द टॉर्क ऑफ एम जी एंड एन वन वील हैव टू राइट डाउन द आर परपेंडिकुलर, सो एन वन इंटू आर परपेंडिकुलर, दिस इज गोइंग टू बी द परपेंडिकुलर डिस्टेंस, दिस इज गोइंग टू बी द परपेंडिकुलर डिस्टेंस फॉर एन वन and that will be equal to L sine 37. What about MG? MG into sorry, so this will be L by 2 cos 37 and if you put the value of N1 as mu MG, I think we should be able to get the answer pretty soon. Mg gets cancelled, mu comes out to be L gets cancelled, mu comes out to be 2 by 3. Please check, bacho. Please check. Please check. Mu comes out to be equal to 2 by 3. Is it okay? Yes, AN, you are very smart. I can totally understand your smartness, but some of the guys here are mere mortals, so we take a bit of time to get the answers, right? I like smart kids, no doubt about it. Okay, sure. I'll tell you the solution once again, but go through the working ones. Go through the working ones. N2 is normal, no doubt. See, the thing is that we have used these two equations. These are translational equilibrium equations, and this is rotational equilibrium, right? So when you are writing torque, then the torque is basically N1 into R perpendicular. This is the line of force and this is R perpendicular. So this R perpendicular is basically length sine 37, right? So this is equal to L sine 37. Similarly, mg line of force is this, and this is the R perpendicular for mg. So this is going to be L by 2 cos 37. And once you have substituted the values, put the value of N1 as mu mg, then we get the minimum coefficient of friction for which ladder does not slip. Please check. Is it fine, beta? RK, is it okay? Fine. Reply quickly. Okay, good. Now we go on to the nemesis. Most of you must have felt at some point of time that angular momentum is the toughest one. So let us try to figure out some important points. So angular momentum for a point mass is R cross P, right? So this is angular momentum of point mass about O, right? So just like बच्चों we discussed for torque, we can also use the same discussion to use angular momentum of point mass. And you know, magnitude wise we can write this as angular momentum mod into R perpendicular. So this is the line of linear momentum, sorry, and this is also mod of linear momentum. So this is line of linear momentum and this dotted distance will be R perpendicular, okay? Also, one popular formula, angular momentum mod is mvr sine theta. This is another form of writing down the angular momentum of a point mass. Thank you, An. Thanks, beta. Nice. So the thing is that these three formulae, bachcho, are based on the angular momentum of a point mass, right? In case of rotational motion, rigid body motion, we also need to write down the angular momentum of a rigid body. So in that case, bachcho, how do we define it? We can say that angular momentum of rigid body is basically integration of R cross P, where P is the angular momentum of a small mass. So that will be dm into v, right? Something like this. So the thing is that bachcho, it will take us a lot of time to calculate this part. So we use a very standard formula which most of you must have known when you have studied angular momentum as L vector is equal to I into omega vector. But this bachcho, this angular momentum is not the total angular momentum. This angular momentum of rigid body is along the axis of rotation. Now, the important thing to note over here is that, bachcho, angular momentum of rigid body need not be completely along axis of rotation. I omega gives the component of total angular momentum along axis of rotation. So there are some popular questions which have come in recent exams. Yeah, there will be GM in due course of time. There will be GM. So this is basically the rod which is rotating and it is making a pendulum. You can assume that this is how it looks like. And if you calculate the angular momentum of this rod, but your direction of that, it won't be along the axis of rotation. It won't be along the axis of rotation. So it will be at some angle to the axis of rotation. So L is equal to I omega, which is a very popular formula, will only give you angular momentum along the axis of rotation only, along omega vector only. So this is not the complete formula, but it helps us to calculate angular momentum for most of the rigid bodies because of its symmetry, because of the symmetrical nature of rotation of rigid bodies. Okay, So if you actually have to calculate the angular moment of rigid body, there is no other option but to use this. This Ganda formula is the only option to get the total angular momentum of the rigid body. Got it? Got the idea, bachcho? Is it fine? Is it okay? Beta, com was discussed in the last class. You can refer the notes over there. We have found out the formula for finding com. Okay. So, this is very important. Now, bachcho, what is conservation of angular momentum? Now, we can also say that, bachcho, that dL by dt is equal to net external torque. And if this is equal to 0, then angular momentum is conserved. Initial angular momentum is final angular momentum. Simple, hai na? No net external torque. Right, that is the condition for conservation of angular momentum. Yeah, SA, I can tell you the condition. I just gave you the example. So, bachcho, this is the way in which the rod is rotating, right? So, its omega vector is over here. But if you calculate its angular momentum vector, bachcho, its angular momentum is in this direction, right? All the components, small particles, angular momentum is in this direction. So, the net angular momentum is also over here. Got it? So, when the net angular momentum is along this and omega is along this, that means angular momentum is not along the omega vector. This is a very popular formula. It has been asked in a couple of questions in JE exams as well. So, I omega will give you the component along omega vector only. That is not a wrong formula. It's just a formula that is not interpreted in a proper manner. So, I omega is going to give you this component of angular momentum. Okay? Yeah. So, we get the question, bachcho. We get the same in the question form which was asked in JE 2012. And in the recent exams also, in one of the papers, we got the similar type of question. So, I would like you to, get the answer to this question. And I think the understanding part is very important. Once you understood, then there should not be any problem. So, there is a small mass attached to a string whose other end is fixed. The mass is undergoing circular motion in xy plane. So, this mass is undergoing the circular motion in xy plane. If the angular momentum system about O, calculated about O, and one is the angular momentum system calculated about P, then what will happen to angular momentum about O and what will happen to angular momentum about P? So, angular momentum about O is simple one. I think MVR sin theta if you apply, bachcho, or you can say R cross P, then R cross P gives you the direction of angular momentum about O over here, right? This is the direction of angular momentum about O. So, this is constant. Angular momentum of about O is constant, right? Both in magnitude and direction, it is constant. What about P? If we actually try to find the direction right now, when the mass is having a velocity into the board, then bachcho, this is the R vector, this is into the board. When you perform the right hand thumb rule, your thumb will come in this direction. That means, bachcho, the angular momentum in itself would, rotate in a circle and it will constitute a conical shape. So, angular momentum about P, bachcho, is actually changing in direction, not in magnitude, but it's changing in direction. And that is why the correct answer is option C. Please check. Is it fine, bachcho? I hope this is clear. It's a very important question. I had taken up this question in the previous crash course as well. Because of its importance, please check out this question. If there is any concern, then ask. If the particle is going like this, the angular momentum will keep rotating like this along with the particle. Okay. But with respect to O, the particle's angular momentum will remain constant. It won't change. Next. Please get the correct answer without any mistake. A particle of mass 2 kg is on a smooth horizontal surface and it moves on a circular path of radius 0.6 meter. The height of the table from ground is given and omega is also given. So, what is the angular momentum about a point on the ground right under the center of circle? So basically, you have to calculate the angular momentum about this point, and angular speed of the particle is given. It is rotating in a circle. Please find. Any hint? I think it's very easy. The hint is that it's very straightforward, very easy. So you are just asked the magnitude of angular momentum. So you can actually think of using any formula associated with point mass of angular momentum. I think MVR sine theta is one of the formula that we had discussed earlier. And you can use that to get the answer. Once you see the radius and the height, you will realize the fact that, you know, they are trying to use a Pythagorean triplet to get the value of r. This distance is r vector magnitude, that is 1. So over here, bachcho, when it is rotating in a circle on a horizontal plane, so its velocity will always make 90 degree. Its velocity will always make 90 degree with the radius vector, right? So we can say that angular momentum magnitude is mvr sine theta, and over here theta is going to be 90 degree, radius is going to be 1, and mass is given as 2, speed is given as, is not given, omega is given, so we can write this as omega r, which is equal to radius is 0.6 into omega is 12. So that gives you the answer as 14.4 kg meter square per second. Please check, bachcho, the correct answer is option A. Nice one, Ritwik, Bunny, Winglet, Chirag, Vishnu, Bob, sub, all got correct. Good job, SP. Next. I think the questions are quite straightforward. You just do not have to make any mistake. You should get the correct answer in your first attempt. Please get the correct answer. So this is an integer type question. You should get an integer answer. What is the correct answer? Please find it out. Have you visited this temple? I haven't, bachcho. I haven't. But I have it in my plans. I know that, you know, in the southern part of India, there are some amazing temples. And all of them are in my to-do list. So, you know, once all this corona thing will get over, I'll definitely have some kind of a tourism trip, something of that sort. Haven't visited anything since the last 1.5 years. Yeah, so bucket list, exactly. Lot of things. So there's a person of 80 kg mass standing at the rim, and the platform is rotating at 5 rpm. The person now starts moving towards the center of platform. What will be the rotational speed of the platform when the person reaches the center? In the previous one, how 90? Okay, so beta, think about it. That, you know, suppose the particle is over here. So when it is, when the velocity vector is going to be along tangent, so that tangent will always be perpendicular to the plane containing the particle and that point with respect to which you are trying to calculate the angular momentum, right? So the thing is that, you know, if you draw that plane, that will be in my axis right now, it's an exit plane. The velocity will be perpendicular to that plane. So automatically the r vector and v vector are always going to be perpendicular. So even if it rotates and comes to a random angle, the point O and the point where you are drawing that v vector, if you will constitute that plane, the velocity is again going to be perpendicular to that plane. Right? Think about it. You will enjoy thinking on that, why the velocity vector is always perpendicular to r vector, right? So 9, yes, Naman, Chirag, Winglet, bilkul, 9 is the correct answer. So good job, guys. So I1 omega 1, angular momentum is conserved. That is the question based on angular momentum is conserved. I1 omega 1 is I2 omega 2. So we just have to write down the proper moment of inertia initially. So platform mass is 200 kg. So mr square by 2 plus mass of man into r square into omega 1 is corresponding to 5. I2 will be only due to the platform, the mass of man contribution will become 0 into omega 2. So when you will substitute the values, bachcho, r square will get cancelled everywhere. So m by 2, 100 plus 80 into omega 1 is equal to 100 into omega 2, which implies omega 2 is equal to how much? 180. So that will be 9 omega 1 by 5. That will be equal to 9 rpm. And therefore the answer is going to be 9. Please check. Is it okay? Sir, do you revise these formulae? How do you remember so many formulae? So there is a saying, bachcho, practice makes a man perfect. And there is no shortcut to success. Right? There is no substitute for hard work. Right, so all of those are applicable for me. I could have easily said that, you know, my date of birth is 14th of March. So I was born on that day when Einstein uncle was born, when Amir Khan was born. So I have been blessed with such a great brain that I automatically, you know, see everything and it gets imprinted on my brain. But bachcho, it's in fact, it's not like that. I would say that, you know, there is a lot of hard work that got involved and I've been going through these things for now, you know, what, like 17, 18 years. So obviously, that type of practice does help me to remember so many things. Okay. That should not be your aim, that you will also take some 16, 17 years to remember all these things. But yeah, the main thing is that, you must all keep revising. Don't try don't be in a hurry to remember everything. So take small steps. Maybe you can sit down during your lunch today and revise formulae based on gravitation, right? So we generally get this idea inside us that, you know, today we will complete everything associated with physics. Today we will complete everything in chemistry and all that. But it does not work like that, okay? So thanks, SR, for praising me, you know, but as you guys all know that how much ever you praise me, I won't be getting any kind of government, and that government is, you know, something like a bad ego for those who don't understand Hindi, okay? So, but thanks for, you know, motivating me and praising me. In fact, you will be surprised that one of my students is teaching on an academy, so that tells me that I'm not that young, okay? Right. So, bachcho, another question. I think it's an easy question, but make sure that you try and get the correct answer, because these are all conceptual questions, right? This is a conceptual question. So, make sure that you try and get the correct answer in your first attempt. Thanks, Winglet. Thank you. Circular platform means disc. Yes, GM. Yes, yes, for sure. Circular platform is basically a disc. Yes. How will the man move on the disc if it's not a disc? If it's a ring, then how will the man move on it? It does not make a lot of sense, right? So there is either one of the options is disc or the other option is ring. So if the man is moving on the circular platform, how will it that be a ring? So the only option left is a disc. Definitely no ghamand, beta. Bilkul nahi. Right, Pierre? No ghamand at all. But yeah, I'll tell you that thing. You know, it happens with everyone. Everywhere, those who perform really well require a lot of hard work and commitment. So basically, you guys should also be ready to do that if you want success. Right? So it's very easy to see the success, but very difficult to perform the hard work required for that success. And that is why it's important for you to understand that, even though the world praises the achievements and in everything that gets reflected in the social media is so hyped, but the hard work associated with that is very, very important for you guys to work on as well. So, bacho, find the angular velocity of rod after collision. Obviously, angular momentum is conserved, right? There is no external force over here. It's all in horizontal surface without any friction. So, initial angular momentum is mu into L. Final angular momentum, bacho, it gets stuck to it. So, the combination of this starts rotating. So, m into L square, this is for mass. And for rod, the moment of inertia is ml square by 3 into omega. Please check, bacho, if this is okay. So, the final omega will be 3u divided by 5l. Please check. That is the answer. Please check, bacho. I see some mistakes committed. Some of you took the mass of rod as m instead of 2m. So, such type of mistakes will always result in you getting negative marks. You have to remain very focused when you are solving the questions. Don't be in a hurry, bacho. Is it fine? Great, great. So the last question before we go on to the T plus R motion, bacho. Let me see how many of you can get it very quickly. The answer to this question: a wheel is rotating freely with angular velocity omega. The moment of inertia is I. Another wheel of moment of inertia 3i is suddenly coupled to the same shaft. The resultant fractional loss in kinetic energy of the system is. Let me see how many of you can get the correct answer in your first attempt without any kind of mistake. Oh my God, thank you, sir, for such type of blessings. I do feel blessed, in the sense that I'm in such a profession where I teach such young guys and energetic guys, and you guys also like to learn from a teacher, because when I remember my all my academic background, the only time the students were really eager to learn from a teacher was actually in 11th and 12th, right? Till 10th, I think most of the times the class usually does not take that much interest in learning, except for a few students, and same goes for engineering college. But yeah, this is the time when everybody remains so focused, and this is the time a teacher also enjoys teaching to students. So definitely, I am blessed to have to be in such a profession, and the energy all comes from you guys, and it's really nice, right? Okay, so I'm getting a few answers. What's the other ways other than JEE? Is it ways to join other institutions? I don't think so. I think whether you can, whichever institute you are going to go, I think if you actually work hard over there, you will again, increase your chances to do well. Life does not end in an IIT or an NIT that, if you don't get a IIT, then your life is, not going to be good. I'll give you a simple example of in my family, my own brother-in-law. He did not study in any IIT or NIT or even in a government college. He studied in a private college, but right now he is working in Amazon and he is based in Seattle. And he's basically, in a job which most of the, guys dream of. Okay. So the thing is that, if you work hard, then the luck starts favoring you. So that is the thing. Life does not end if you don't get into IIT. But yeah, if you work hard and you get into IIT, then what's bad in that? Okay. Right. So obviously D is the correct answer, bacho. Most of you have got it correct. Excellent. I1 omega 1 is equal to I2 omega 2. And if you just solve the question, I into omega is equal to, when you put the second, wheel onto it, the omega 2 comes out to be equal to omega divided by 4. So what is the initial kinetic energy? If I calculate it, it is half I omega square. And what is the final kinetic energy, bacho? I will increase to 4i, but omega decreases to omega by 4. And obviously, this will be equal to initial kinetic energy divided by 4, because this 16 term will involve this extra 4 term. So we can say that the kinetic energy became 1/4, and therefore the loss of energy is 3/4. How 4i? Beta, if you put a disk onto a original disk, then the moment of inertia basically of the system will become I plus 3i, right? This is equal to 4i. Okay. Yeah, I say this thing inspires even me as well. Okay. So hard work does pay. You never know when it will pay, but yeah, it does. So I plus 3i is 4i. Is it fine? Okay. Now, bachcho, if we go on to the discussion of T plus R motion, we know that, you know, in T plus R, there is a combined translational plus rotational motion. The center of mass is moving with velocity v, and all the particles are moving with omega with respect to center of mass. That is the idea, right? So we assume in such a situation that the body does try to go with respect to center of mass, because the moment of inertia about the com is minimum, right? It's the minimum possible. So in general case, we say that body performing T plus R, motion is equivalent to pure translation of V and pure rotational of omega with respect to com, right? So that is the idea. And if we consider the kinematics of T plus R motion, again, something which you must all be aware of, bachcho, we say that, you know, for any point where we have to write down the velocity of any particle, in that case, bachcho, there is a vector sum of, you know, two components of velocities. One is the linear part. So every point will have a linear component of velocity, right? And the angular component, the circular component will also get vectorially added. So we can say that, you know, omega will contribute in the velocity as omega r over here. And the resultant of these two will give you the net velocity. So the net velocity, suppose these points are A, B, C, D. So bachcho, the net velocity I'm trying to write down for each of the points. Velocity of A can be written as V plus omega r I cap. Velocity of B can be written as V I cap minus omega r j cap. Or we can say that magnitude of B is going to be equal to what? This vector is going to be root of V square plus omega r square. I hope this is clear to all. Any doubts in this, bachcho? I hope this is fine. Similarly, Vc can be written as V minus omega r I cap, and similarly Vd. Vd is nothing but the vector sum of these two vectors. So this is root of V square plus omega r whole square. Okay. Similarly, bachcho, you can also find the acceleration. Suppose A, omega and alpha are given. In this case, it will have three components. One is A, other is R alpha, and the third is the radial acceleration, which is missed by most of the students. So you don't have to miss that. So acceleration of A will be equal to, bachcho, A plus R alpha I cap minus omega square R j cap, right? And the vector sum of these three vectors will give you the net acceleration of point A. This is something which you have to remember. Same goes for point over here. This is A, R alpha will be downwards, and omega square R will be towards center. So acceleration of this point, acceleration of B will be equal to A minus omega square R I cap minus R alpha J cap, right? This is the manner in which you can write down the accelerations. Okay. Right. Rolling. Now, rolling or pure rolling means the same thing. There is nothing as such as impure rolling. Okay. So, bachcho, over here, we can say that if this is performing pure rolling, वी से दैट द कॉन्टैक्ट पॉइंट्स हैव स्टैटिक फ्रिक्शन एक्टिंग राइट इन प्योर रोलिंग रिजिड बॉडी undergoing rolling have static friction acting on the contact points. Right. So, bachcho, in this case, we can say that downwards, we wrote it earlier that V and omega are acting at the bottommost point. Over here, V is equal to R omega becomes the condition for pure rolling. But always V equal to R omega is not the condition. Here, we can use that this is the, here this is condition for rolling at ground. So, bachcho, suppose you have a plank. Suppose you have a plank which is in itself moving with V1 and there is a wheel which is on the plank and it is moving with V and omega. What is the condition of rolling over here? Can anybody tell me? Condition for rolling, bachcho, quickly. Condition for rolling over here. What is the condition of rolling? Condition for rolling for this case in which there is a wheel, there is a plank and there is pure rolling happening at the contact surface. Bachcho, please tell me. V plus V1 is equal to omega into, there has to be some R as well, right? R is also given. But so what we can say that this point is moving ahead by V minus R omega and this point on the plank is moving ahead by V1. So for static friction over here, the condition of rolling will be V minus R omega is equal to V1 or we can say V is equal to V1 plus R omega. Now let me see how many of you got the correct answer. V1 plus R omega is equal to V. I think AY got it correct. I think nobody else got it correct. Please check, bachcho. Please check. There should be static friction at the contact point. So, the relative velocity needs to be zero. So, I hope this is clear that condition for pure rolling will be V minus R omega is equal to V1. Is it fine? Okay. Rolling on an inclined plane. Now, when pure rolling happens on an inclined plane, bachcho, we must remember that, you know, the acceleration of center of mass has a simple formula. Not going to derive it, but I hope you all remember that it is equal to g sine theta upon 1 plus I upon mr square. Do you remember? This is an important formula and once you remember this, I think you can quickly get the other things associated with the rolling on inclined plane. Right. Okay, so this is extremely important and you can also maybe you know remember the formula of friction that it is equal to mg sine theta upon 1 plus mr square upon I. The reverse happens over here. It is not that useful as compared to A, but yeah, you can remember in this manner that you know based on the value of moment of inertia you will get the value of frictional force when there is no rolling, no slipping. Right, everything over here, it is representing no slipping case. Okay. Kinetic energy formula in T plus R, bachcho. Half M V com square plus half I omega square. I about com. Right, so this is V and this is omega. So this is basically sum of T and R kinetic energies. So that will give you the total kinetic energy of body performing T plus R. Angular momentum. That is the angular momentum of com plus angular momentum of body with respect to com. That is the very standard formula which is used. It is, I think, a tricky formula in the sense that what are these two formulas representing? So, I am giving you a idea of what it is. If we write angular momentum over O, then bachcho, this first term is basically giving you the simplest formula of angular momentum of point mass formula. This is basically relating the angular momentum of com assuming com to be point mass, assuming com to be point mass. So over here bachcho, we can say that about O, the angular momentum of body, the first term is going to be zero, because if this is the point mass, then we can say that, you know, torque of that basically R perpendicular will come out to be zero. So the first term is going to be zero. The second term, when you sit on the comb, this rod is rotating with omega. So this becomes I about O into omega, and you can write it down as ML square by 12 into omega, and the direction will be along the omega direction, that is out of board. Please check, right? So this is an important formula, more useful for advanced. I don't think that it is that relevant for mains, but it's pretty important for usually advanced, right? IAR, the final part that we're going to discuss. What is the IAR of a rolling sphere? Anybody? On ground. What is the IAR of a rolling sphere on ground? Anybody? Fatafat batao, quickly. I hope you guys know about it. What is the location of IAR of a rolling sphere? This is a rolling sphere. What is the IAR? This point is the IAR, right? So what is the benefit of IAR? Kinetic energy total can simply be written as half into I about IAR into omega square. In fact, torque formula can also be used. Tau is equal to I about IAR into alpha. This is torque about IAR. Right, so because of these two benefits, IOR can be used. Although this is again, you know, more important for such situations in which you already know the location of IOR. There you can use these forms to get the answer. But so let us solve a couple of questions based on it. Let me see if you can get the answer quickly. Please try. This is a good question, actually. It's a good question. Yeah, this is a special case. It's not always. That is why I've written that this is a rolling sphere. In that case, the IOR is on ground. But suppose if there is slipping, if the mass is slipping, then how will we get IOR? You have to find the velocities of any two points, right? So if this is velocity is directed towards right, and there is the velocity which is directed at some angle, then drop a perpendicular from these velocities, and you know, the point of intersection of these two velocities will give you IOR, right? But I don't think it has ever been used, right? And basically the usefulness of IOR is that all points on the body perform pure rotational motion about IOR. That is the more usefulness which I see of IOR. Otherwise I don't think it's of that much use. Okay, no beta RK, I don't think D is correct. Don't be in a hurry. This is a good question. This is an excellent question. And don't be in a hurry, you will make mistakes otherwise. I think yes, Vishnu Winglet, you both seem correct. Now this is a very interesting question, because you know the three masses, they have not given anything about the masses of these three bodies. They can be different, they can be same, it doesn't really matter. Their radius is given, which is different, which is not same as well. Still the speed of center of mass at the bottom, when it is given as same, the ratio of maximum height are having some sort of ratio. And this is very interesting to get how we are able to get the answers so cleanly and so quickly. So, bachcho, I'll give you a minute more to try, and then we will discuss it in detail. It's an excellent question. So, let me see if I can get more answers in this question. So, Sujal has also got the correct answer as C. You know, interestingly, the option C was not there in this mains exam. It was an online paper, I think, and it was a bonus question because none of the options were matching with the exact answer. So it might happen with you as well. So in those moments, don't be in a hurry, you know, and make some sort of a silly mistake and keep wasting your time. If you feel that you have done correctly and it's not matching, then move ahead. Okay. Yes, yes, PI. So the thing is that suppose we talk of any normal rigid body and we are giving it a speed V, okay, and if it goes to a height h, obviously the h max is h, that means its V is 0 and always it is performing rolling motion, then its omega is also 0. So by conservation of energy, we can say that the loss in KE must be equal to gain in P, right? The loss in KE must be equal to gain in P. And what is the loss in kinetic energy, bachcho? Half mv square plus half I omega square is equal to mgh, hai na? So if we just think about how to manipulate this function, which becomes independent of h, and we also get the ratios of h in a manner in which, you know, we only are remaining with the v, and there might be associated term of I and mr square in it. So we can basically take half common, m common, v square common, this becomes 1 plus I upon m, and omega square we can write as v square, which comes outside because I have taken it common, upon r square. So this r square term comes in denominator, right, and this becomes mgh, and beautifully we can say that, you know, m gets cancelled over here. I upon mr square is a constant value for these three bodies. So h is proportional to, bachcho, v square is same, 1 plus I upon mr square. I hope this is clear to all. H is proportional to this value. Now for ring, what is this proportional to? 1 plus I of ring is mr square, so this becomes proportional to 2. Similarly, h of cylinder, and that is a solid cylinder. So solid cylinder moment of inertia is mr square by 2. So this becomes 1 plus 1 by 2. So it becomes proportional to 3 by 2, and h of sphere, that becomes proportional to 1 plus 2 by 5, it becomes proportional to 7 by 5. So when the ratio is 2 is to 3 by 2 is to 7 by 5, we have to be careful in getting the answer as 20 is to 15 is to 14. Please check, bachcho, that gives you answer as option C. Please check. Is it clear to all? Now this is a very interesting analysis, and you must remember this one and don't forget it, okay? Please check, is it okay? So bachcho, my add-on question is, if you have understood, is the time taken to reach over here, is the time taken to reach these heights, h max, is same for all bodies? Is it so? If time taken by these three bodies are t1, t2 and t3. So add-on question in this same is, are these times same, or if they are different, then put these times in increasing order, which of these bodies will take the maximum time to reach their h max? What do you think is the answer? And be careful, don't be in a hurry. If this is indeterminate sort of a thing, that's why we cannot find it, then also it's okay. But if you can give me the answer, let me see which of them is taking the maximum amount of time. And initial velocity given to each of the bodies is same. Yes, RK, the radius is different, but I upon mr square will involve I of the same radius as r is, right? So r will be equal to r by 4 for solid sphere, so that r by 4 will get cancelled. This r is general r, this is not r of ring, this is a general r, standard r, okay? So t1 greater than t2 equal to s greater than t3, same time will be same. I don't think time will be same. if I use the standard equation of motion, v is equal to u plus at, v is 0, u is same for all, but is the acceleration same for all? Now, we had just discussed earlier that acceleration is g sine theta upon 1 plus I upon mr square, right? So, if we compare the acceleration values with regards to I upon mr square, obviously the retardation over here will be maximum for which denominator is minimum. And denominator is minimum for which shape? Denominator is minimum for solid sphere, right? I hope you can also understand that. So, denominator is minimum for solid sphere, so its retardation is maximum. So, it will take the minimum time. So, obviously T3, which is for solid sphere, will be less as compared to T2, will be less as compared to T1. Please check, bachcho. Please check. Beta, acceleration of sphere is maximum, so its time taken to get the velocity 0 is minimum. Please check. Understood? I hope this is clear. Got it? Acceleration is minimum for a ring, right? Because over here, this term will be 1 plus 1, 2. So, acceleration is minimum. Therefore, the time taken for velocity to become 0 is maximum. So, T1 is going to be maximum. They are not going to reach their maximum heights at the same time. Okay? Right. So, bachcho, I upon mr square will be max for ring. Yes. So, its acceleration will be minimum and time taken will be maximum. Yes. So, let's see the final question of today, bachcho. I think we have discussed quite a lot of things and I hope that there would have been some clarity in the types of question that we have discussed. And if these type of questions do come in your exam, then you should be in a position to get the answer. A solid cylinder roller. So, it's a cricket pitch roller and it is pulled on, in fact, yeah, it is pulled on the cricket pitch itself. So, if you have ever observed, then there is the roller and you know, there is a handle on which it is connected by through the central axis of the cylinder. So, it is given a force F and you have to assume rolling without slipping. Then what is the acceleration of the cylinder? Angular acceleration. Angular acceleration of the cylinder is how much? I think one of the easiest questions that you could have ever get. And my intention of giving you this question was to also tell you the concept of IAVR. So, bachcho, over here, if force is being applied on the, on the center of cylinder, then IUR, we know that for pure ruling, IUR will be this point, right? So, we can say that torque about IUR will be equal to I about IUR into alpha. Now, what exactly is torque about IUR? This is F into R. I about IUR will be for cylinder, solid cylinder, it will be mr square by 2 plus mr square by parallel axis theorem into alpha. So, if you just solve this, it's very easy. R will get cancelled. Alpha will be equal to 2f divided by 3mr. Right? So, that gives you option D. And so soon. So, IUR concept is very useful to get the alpha very quickly and you can use it in your practice questions and such type of problems if you are being asked. You can do it very quickly. Bachcho, so can you tell me the answer of alpha had the force been applied over here by using the concept of IUR on a solid sphere? Please tell me. I think you can get it within 10 seconds now. Assume this to be solid cylinder. So, if a force is acting on the topmost point of the solid cylinder, what will be the alpha of this? Please tell me. I think it should be a very quick answer. Should not take a lot of time. You don't even need the value of friction to calculate alpha because torque of friction is going to be 0 about IUR. Yes. This term will be same, no difference, only the torque one, F into 2R will come. So, the answer will be 4F upon 3MR. For sure. Right? No doubt about it. So, this is a very useful method to get the answers quickly. I hope you liked it, bachcho. And this is what our lesson of today was. We have now completed our quota of time. So, bachcho, I hope you enjoyed it, you liked it, you learned something from it. And keep enjoying, keep working hard. And, you know, practice these questions again to develop more confidence and clarity in these topics. Keep solving the mock test and full test, which are available for free on Amazon Academy, bachcho. And we will meet very soon on Saturday now, right? And we will meet on Saturday at 11 a.m. for English class and 3 p.m. for English class, right? So, bachcho, I hope you enjoyed the session today and I enjoyed as well. Bye, Vishnuji, bye, SP. Thank you, beta. Bye-bye, Winglet, VK, PR, thank you. SR, Sujal, bye bachcho. So all the very best to all of you. Keep working hard, keep improving, and you know, we will meet so soon. God bless you all bachcho. Bye bye.
For detailed videos, daily practice problems and live chat, visit academy.amazon.in or download the app.